Onze missie is, zoals ik zei, dus een proces van lange adem. En de huidige omstandigheden zijn wereldwijd eigenlijk niet zo gunstig, democratisch gezien. Laat staan direct democratisch. Daarom is het natuurlijk een heel mooi voorrecht ook dat we dus een specialiste ter zake, Clara Egger, verwelkomen, die ons meer zal vertellen over wat er momenteel in Frankrijk beweegt. En Clara heeft samen met Raoul Magny-Berton bij de politicologen al het een en ander dus ook activistisch gedaan, hè. Ze zijn ons ook al een paar jaar bekend, want een ander lid van ons, Paul Nollens, zeide ons het initiatief door van deze twee geëngageerde academici. Een initiatief dat ze namen in de Franse Dauphiné, een oud graafschap tegen de Zwitserse en Italiaanse grens, hoofdstad Grenoble. Ze hebben daar dus een bindend referendum opgezet, met experten en zo, allemaal heel goed georganiseerd. En dat heette dus Dauphiné Democratique. Heel mooi initiatief in een toch extreem gecentraliseerd land als Frankrijk. Clara schreef ook trouwens met Raoul Magny-Berton, die er trouwens ook zal spreken, misschien binnen een maand of zo. Ze schreef met hem het boek Le Référendum d'Initiative Citoyenne Expliqué à tous. Je vindt een link naar om het boek even te bekijken en een kleine review zo, ook in de chat. Het is zo'n beetje Franse tegenhanger van ons basiswerk, hè, dus waar je ook een Google PDF link in de chat vindt. En goed, nu inderdaad, Bert zei het daarnet al, dus in het laatste Global Forum for Direct Democracy in en dat nu dus uiteraard online was, dus ingericht door onze zustermaatschappij in Keulen. Daar zag je dus Clara bezig en hij zei, ja, professor in Groningen, dat is interessant en ze kent zeer veel van de democratische situatie in Nederland en blijkbaar ook in andere landen. Nu, we zijn dus erg blij dat Clara zo enthousiast toezegde voor deze webinar en zelfs meer voor dan één webinar, hè. Vandaag gaat het dus over de toestand in Frankrijk. Volgende keer, over 14 dagen, zal ze misschien over Nederland spreken. We kunnen het nog altijd eens even nu vastleggen. Clara Egger is afkomstig van Franstalig Zwitserland. Ze spreekt onberispelijk Nederlands en schrijven zeker. Nu, we hebben ze daarnet horen praten, dat is dus heel goed. Maar ze vindt van zichzelf dat ze toch de taal iets te weinig beheerst om eigenlijk lezingen te geven. Dat willen we best begrijpen. En ze zal dus vanavond dan ook in het Engels spreken. Maar uw vragen kan u dus gerust in het Nederlands stellen. Dus schrijf ze best onderaan daar in de chat, tenzij u ze al doorgestuurd hebt. Voilà, verder weten we dus dat we microfoons afgezet houden, tenzij u zelf wilt spreken, hè, maar normaal gezien stellen we vragen achteraf natuurlijk om alles heel ordentelijk te laten verlopen. Ja, ik denk dat het dat zo ongeveer kan zijn. Now I like to hand over to you, Mrs. Egger. Please have the floor.
Heel erg bedankt, allemaal. I would rather speak in English, if you don't mind. I've been in living in Groningen for close to 2 years now, trying to learn Netherlands as soon as quickly as I can, but I'm not there yet. So I will speak in English. If you don't understand what I say, just let me know, and I would gladly explain. Thanks a lot for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be with you tonight. I thought that I could start speaking about France and what happened with the Yellow Vest movement because, I mean, in many respects, I think France is also behind Belgium in many ways, also in terms of centralization, in terms of also the debate about direct democracy. And perhaps I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Yellow Vest movement. Yeah, the Gilets Jaunes. Yeah, so you know a bit
No.
what perhaps happened around it. But I will sort of, yeah, give a narrative of what happened in France, and what is the situation right now, and what can we learn from what is going on in France. So basically, how did the Yellow Vest movement start? So it was in November 2018. I don't know if you remember, it was 2 years ago. And it started with protests against a tax on fuel. So it was the government implemented a new tax that was highly discriminating against rural areas. And of course, in France, you have a lot of these rural areas where you need a car, right? To go, if you have to go to the bakery, if you have to bring your kids to school, you have to have a car. And these people will already feel that they were quite, I would say, targeted by the government in Paris, had this new tax, and they could not stand it anymore. So they said, okay, we're going to do a protest, and we're going to use a symbol that is cheap and that everyone has in his car. So they took this yellow vest and they went in a roundabout to protest. And at the beginning, it was really about this tax, right? Saying, well, we don't want to, why are always poor people paying? Why is it always on us and not on other, you know, layers of society? So it was a type of debate. Of course, many things were said at that time. And it started, and weekly people would meet, right, in the roundabout. I think France is the capital of Europe for the roundabout. I don't know if you drive in France, but you have like so many of them. So people who did not really meet before would just gather, you know, on the Saturday morning. They would go to the roundabout, bring, you know, some bread, some coffee, and discuss. So it lasted in November. So the end of November, it was really focusing on the tax. And in December, the key demand was about direct democracy. So in 4 weeks, it shifted, right? It went from the tax dimension to, okay, now what we want is we want more political rights. We are fed up with the idea that we can't, you know, each time we have to contest a law, we have to go in the street, we can't initiate any debate. So what we want is direct democracy. And as we are in France, they call it sort of their way, which is the RIC, for citizen initiated referendum. And the idea at that time was to defend four things. So basically the idea, so it is called the RIC CARL, C-A-R-L. So C is for constitutional. So it's the idea that people can change the constitution. So they can initiate a change in the constitution, and then people would vote on this change of constitution, as it is the case in Switzerland, for example. The A is for repeal. It's abrogatif in French, but it's to repeal a law. And this was the tax, introduction of the new tax was clearly targeted at that time. R is for recall. So the idea that you can stop the mandate of a politician and call this politician back. And L was for legislative. So not constitutional law, but the power to make ordinary laws. And they it was also called, you can find this expression, which is in all manners, en toute matière, which means that the idea is that you can use it at all level, local, regional, national, and from the constitutional dimension to the very local, you know, legislation. So it started like this in December, and the situation at the beginning was really funny because the mainstream media in France started covering the topic very nicely. Well, they would say, oh, well, this is a long-term practice in Switzerland. That's an interesting idea. The prime minister at that time even said, I don't know who can oppose direct democracy. So it was, you know, sort of in December, we thought that, okay, this was sort of a time in history where there was a sort of agreement that it was the new sort of measure to introduce to further, I would say, yeah, increase the rights of the people and the political rights in the people. And the more the demand becomes, you know, super vocal and people would say, no, this is what we want, then it shifted. And then the media started portraying direct democracy as an idea from the far right, and this is a direct quote from Le Monde, who did an investigation showing that it's only far right parties who are defending these measures. The president Macron said, well, no, direct democracy is not suited for a country like France because we are a representative democracy. So it's not in our culture. We're not Switzerland. You know, the French are so they lack discipline, right? They're not able to really make decisions by themselves. And then it was like this every day, right? With facts that were untrue, clearly trying to convey the message that this is really, that was not good. So perhaps you have this in Belgium too, but we had, for example, polls about, yes, if we introduce direct democracy, then people will ask for the death penalty to be back again. If we introduce direct democracy, women will be denied the right to vote because people will vote against women's suffrage. So that type of things that really came from nowhere, but all the media were saying this type of things, right? So this is where my colleague Raoul and I, we are studying direct democracy in Europe. So we thought, oh my God, we have to do something about this, because if the debate is so about, you know, this sort of fake news, we have to explain what it is. And we know a lot about what direct democracy is actually doing. And a lot of countries in Europe are using it. So it's not a disaster. It's a really small step, right? And after this sort of very, you know, refusal of direct democracy, what the French government decided to do is to say, okay, direct democracy, it's a no-go, and we don't want to discuss about it. But we're gonna have a big debate, what is called the Grand Débat. So we're gonna have a very big debate. And Macron went to all the cities in France. So having this long, sometimes 6-7 hours debate with people. And you're gonna tell me, so there was the sort of, the speech of the president, you're gonna tell me what you want. So people would gather in city hall and explain what was going on. And at that time, it was a big scandal in France because basically the government hired a consultancy to predefine the topics that would be discussed in this debate. So people would say, for example, the government said, you can discuss anything you want, but direct democracy. This is a no-go. So you would say, for example, if someone in the audience would ask, hey, and what about direct democracy? No, there was a big cut in the recording, and people would say, no, but this is not a topic. This is not something we're going to discuss today. So this was, it took place this way. At the same time, the Yellow Vest organized a parallel debate called the True Debate, where again, direct democracy was very high, right? It was sort of the first demand. So people started organizing around direct democracy. At that time, we didn't have, as you have in Belgium, Mère Démocratie. We had no central organization to defend that. There was like local organization defending direct democracy from the 80s, people back in the 80s willing to really have direct democracy in France, but not a real national right movement. So it started to sort of organize, it started to organize in the European elections. So we had one list asking for direct democracy in Europe and in France. And since then, the situation is quite, I would say, difficult. And perhaps this is, we can take some good ideas from you and we can discuss how to make this move on. Because what is really interesting is that 75% of people in France defend direct democracy. So they want it. They say it's a good thing and we have to have it. 90% of the French population in survey knows what is direct democracy after the Yellow Vest. So they know that it's something that is, you know, done in Switzerland, that it's, you can make the proposal yourself, initiated laws, etc. But still, all the political parties are against it. So an interesting example of this is there is a political party in France called La France Insoumise, who is far left, I would say far left, who did propose a law. So it was a law proposal to introduce direct democracy. But it was really tricky because it was not on constitutional matters, not binding. So the idea would be that, yes, you can call a referendum, but I mean, if decision makers, they don't want to respect the results, then, well, they can. And it was with a lot of, you know, it was really an unclear measure. The only thing that I would say politicians are okay to compromise on is the recall. So the idea that you can have a referendum to recall politicians. But this is the only really measure that there is an agreement on. And the same goes at the local level. Well, actually, so we had the municipal election last year in France. They were really perturbated because of Corona. So a lot of quite a few elected mayors died because of, you know, organizing the election in rather unsafe condition, I would say. And again, at the local level, it's actually illegal to do direct democracy. So some municipalities tried to do it. So they did try to have a mechanism. So Grenoble was part of it, and Raoul can perhaps explain to you because he did design the mechanism in Grenoble. But it's always cancelled by legal authorities. So the legal courts will say no. You in France, cities can't decide of the way they take decisions. This is something done at the central level. So we had a lot of lists were asking for more direct democracy, but this is the way it is done in France. It's just that it's illegal. So if you design this mechanism, it can be broken by la préfecture. So the representative of the central government would say, no way, this is not allowed in French law. So right now the situation is that within all the form of initiative and referendum, all the groups defending it are willing to introduce in priority constitutional referendum. So the idea that people could initiate a change in the constitution. Why? Because the idea was that if you can change the constitution as a citizen, first, the constitution is the most important document you have because it's sort of the rules of the game. So it is citizens have to design the rule of the games and not policymakers, because if it is policymakers, then they design the rules that actually suit themselves, but not the other and not the voters. So this is the idea, is to really have the constitutional referendum in priority, because once you have it, you can create the recall referendum, because you can do whatever you want, right? The constitution is really high in terms of the law legal parameter, right? So this is a bit where we are. The Yellow Vest movement now is more or less, I would say, dead, even if there still is, you know, some people willing to do things. But of course, I don't know if you've followed the news, but the level of, I would say, police violence was very high. The people, at some point, they got, you know, it lasted six months every Saturday on the roundabout, asking for something that the government will never, ever grant. Because the idea was really that we can discuss of anything but direct democracy. This is not something we're going to do. And we had, it was quite interesting because, so when we wrote the book, we were invited to a French media called France Inter, which is sort of the national radio in France. And it was very interesting because we were invited with national politicians. And each time we would speak of direct democracy, they would say, no, but it's good that people participate, right? Let's give a right for people to express themselves. In the end, we decide, right? But it's at least they are happy, right? They do participate. And it's very hard to make policymakers aware that deciding and participating is not the same thing. People, they don't want to participate. They don't want to spend time discussing how, you know, or suggesting ideas, and in the end, you don't know what will end up. What the demand is that we can, that there is a decision that is taken from the citizens without any form of interference of elected officials, that they accept to let this power go and let citizens have the right to initiate proposition and to vote this proposition. The other elements that was offered as two other elements that were offered by the government to sort of appease the demand for direct democracy. The first one was what we call referendum d'initiative partagée, which is shared initiative referendum. Perhaps the name ring a bell for you. It's a tool we have in the French constitution, which allows a share of the parliament to suggest a referendum on an issue only if they are supported by 4 million of citizens. 4 million of citizens is the highest threshold in the world. So Macron said, yeah, we're gonna reduce that, we're gonna find a way. So there was a first attempt ever in history. This new article dates back from 2008. And for the first time ever, we had an attempt for the shared initiative referendum, and it was about the privatization of Paris airport. Perhaps you follow that, but yes, basically the government decided to sell Paris airports to a private entity. And there was this, you know, some deputies were against that. So representatives were against that. So they started collecting signatures, and the initiative was a failure, complete failure, because the number of signatures requested is enormous. I mean, 4 million of people signing it is just impossible. It's something you can't get in close to 1 month. And this is something I would say that has also similarity to what we currently see in the Netherlands about the repeal referendum. And I can perhaps, we can discuss that in another webinar, but I don't know if you followed also this discussion. So in the Netherlands, there is an agreement that the repeal referendum needs to be introduced in the constitution. It needs to be binding, but the level of the quorum, so the threshold needed to approve the referendum is super high. So it's gonna be the last amendment we had in Dutch law was that to be valid a referendum, so at least half of the people who voted for the last election needs to be against the law. Again, that would be one of the most difficult referendum to win in Europe. And we know that when referendum are very, very hard to use, they don't reach the effect that they are supposed to reach, right? Because direct democracy is producing very powerful effect on, you know, the sense of also inclusiveness, the level of political competence of the people, the level of political knowledge. So these are also ways, you know, how you can kill a referendum is introducing very high quorums, very high requirements for the number of signatures. And that is the same thing that we are currently witnessing in the Netherlands. We are seeing it also in France. And the other thing that the government did organize is the citizen assembly on climate. Also as a way to counter demands for direct democracy. So saying, okay, direct democracy is a no, but we can give you, you know, citizen assembly where you can speak about climate. And perhaps against you have followed that, but it's 150 citizens randomly selected who worked a lot about climate issues. And in the end, so initially the government said, well, I'm gonna approve everything. And now they did reject the five most controversial measures. So it's the introduction of a taxation. So this is also, again, a very good example that, you can have many other tools, but as long as people can't decide, so they can't vote, they don't have the right to vote, that will be, you know, elected official who will decide whether or not they will follow. I mean, of course, policymakers, they don't follow what they don't want to follow, what is outside of the scope and outside of their agenda. So it's a bit the situation we have in France. We are a bit stuck, to be honest, in this very, I would say, people are a bit tired and they feel that it's going to take a lot of time to have the referendum, the initiative and referendum. And the latest, I would say, development was the creation of the French sister of Mère Démocratie Belgium, which is an organization gathering all the association in Belgium in France that were supportive of the initiative and referendum. And perhaps there is a need to sort of summarize what I said. I hope that in the next seminar we'll be able to do it in Dutch. I can swear that I try my best. But I leave it here. And I think it's, well, if you have any question about the situation in France and how it is now and how it is also in the Netherlands, let's discuss after this not so short, I would say, introduction.
Ik sta echt verbaasd over dat de GLS zo echt voor het referendum gaan.
Ja, ja.
En dat dat op heel hoog niveau dus gewoonweg not done is. Hè?
Nee.
Dat is dus echt not done. En wij ervaren, ja, in zelfs in onze middens, onze direct-democratische middens, dat wij, ik dan en Guido en zo, dat wij nogal fanatiek overkomen. Maar als ik dat dan vergelijk met de gele hesjes in Frankrijk, dan moeten we echt gewoonweg voor ons ding gaan, hè?
Ja, dat is inderdaad wel...
Fijn, maar dat is nu nog geen samenvatting.
Guido, nee, maar inderdaad...
Misschien het, eventjes die...
Maar wel nu, ja, misschien voor wie het zou nodig hebben. Dus Clara heeft dus eventjes geschetst wat er in Frankrijk op gebied van directe democratie gaande is. De startsituatie was dus dat het eigenlijk gewoon niet besproken kon worden zelfs. Dus de officiële politiek blokte alle discussie erover af. Dan is er dus die opstand geweest van de gele hesjes, naar aanleiding van die brandstofprijzen die de pan uitswingden. En dus de mensen voelden zich echt compleet tekort gedaan erin. Maar al snel zijn de gele hesjes blijkbaar overgegaan tot eisen die meer algemeen democratisch waren. Zij wilden zelf kunnen beslissen. Verbeter me, Clara, als ik dingen verkeerd zeg, hoor. Er waren een paar casussen zo. Er was iets in de wet, in de grondwet, dat wel een soort, hoe heette dat nu weer? Een soort referendum. Het was eerder een soort petitie, als ik het goed begrepen heb, mogelijk maakte. Maar dus de drempel om daaraan te kunnen deelnemen was dus hoeveel miljoen handtekeningen? Dat was enorm. 5 miljoen, ja, voilà. Ja, dus dat is totaal onwerkbaar natuurlijk. Oké. En dus, dan is er dus die klimaatconventie geweest. Tussen haakjes, ik weet dus dat Macron zijn idee om een klimaatconventie te organiseren, dus met andere woorden, een geloten burgerraad die dus zou discussiëren over hoe moet de Franse regering de klimaatproblemen aanpakken, dat hij dat gehaald heeft van David van Rijbroek. Dus dat was tijdens een diner hier ergens, ik weet niet meer welk diner, maar enfin, het doet er niet toe, waar ook David van Rijbroek uitgenodigd was. En hij zat dus in de buurt van Macron. En hij werd voorgesteld aan Macron en David van Rijbroek mocht dus eventjes vertellen met wat hij bezig was. En dus zijn boeken die hij geschreven had. En Macron, geloof ik, had dat boekje gelezen, maar dat is een klein boekje over, hoe heet het daar, het Duitsstalig gebied in België. Dus mijn geheugen eventjes, maar goed.
De Oostkantons.
Ja, dus de Oostkantons, dat één dorp daar met die mijn daarin. Maar goed, speelt nu geen rol. En dan sprak David van Rijbroek natuurlijk al over zijn boek, hè, dat toch veel stof doen opwaaien heeft, dat veel vertaald is, over tegen verkiezingen. En over dus burgerraden die dus geloot worden. En Macron was enorm geïnteresseerd. Ja, ze geniaal zetten en zo. En op het einde dus van dat diner beloofde hij van Rijbroek, ik ga dat bij ons doen. Ik organiseer zo'n burgerraad. Maar kijk, dan blijkt dus bijvoorbeeld dat dat wel een succes was. Aanvankelijk zo leek het. Maar uiteindelijk, wat er uit de voorstellen kwam, daar zijn 5 interessante, zeer interessante voorstellen geschrapt gewoon door de politiek. En zo dus zien we dat dat is nog altijd heel sterk in de klauwen van de politiek zit. Maar goed, er beweegt wel heel veel. Bijvoorbeeld die gele hesjes hebben enorm veel in gang gezet. Want nu weet bijvoorbeeld 90% van de Fransen dat er zoiets bestaat als directe democratie. Terwijl ze voorheen dat helemaal niet kenden. Enfin, dat is zo ongeveer wat ik daarover zou.
Dat is heel goed.
Dank u. Ja, zijn er daar vragen over en bedenkingen? Mag dus in het Nederlands, hè?
Ja, I see a question from Henk. Yeah,
it's a
question in Dutch's form, but thanks, Henk, a lot. I think that's a super good point, right? The idea that there is no school that trains people in, you know, being anti-democracy, especially elected officials. Whereas, well, in France, we can debate that, but it's clear that. But so, what happened? Why is it so difficult? Well, because it's also a huge, actually, loss of power. The first political parties that have to agree with that, they agree with losing power. And this is actually my experience of speaking with politicians. It's always the fear of losing power, and especially the idea that the opposition, so opposing parties, will use that to cancel each and every measure that they want to take. And what they don't see is that it's also a responsibility, right? Because when there is direct democracy, if as an opposition party, you say, well, I'm gonna, you know, just cancel your law with a referendum and you organize a petition, then if people don't follow you, you end up like you're in a very bad situation because you sort of say, okay, yeah, I have the capacity of sort of changing the law. And then if people don't follow you, they don't. And this is something we saw in Grenoble. It's the idea that when Grenoble, the city, so the ruling party of the country, of the city of Grenoble decided to have a local referendum, the first thing they said to oppose it, so the elected city council, was, oh, no, we should not do that because the opposition will take, you know, laws to, and they have already 3 petitions to cancel our decision. And once the direct democracy tool was in place, the opposition party, they canceled all their petition because they saw that they could not make it to the number of signatures, that people will not follow them. So this is also sort of a way also of making sure that political parties, when they do something, they have the support of at least a share of the population, that they sort of open themselves to that. But of course, yeah, it's very difficult for them to accept. What we know from in the book we wrote with Raoul, and we are trying to translate it in Dutch, so it's a friendly invitation to someone we can help us with that, but with a chapter on Belgium and the Netherlands in the end, and not France, of course. But what we see is that historically, direct democracy was implemented in 3 ways. The first one is a protest. Now we see Switzerland as a very, you know, peaceful country with codes everywhere and people who are very friendly to each other. At some point, because of the demand for direct democracy, the country was very close to a civil war because the people would fight to get direct democracy. So the people in charge, the elected people said, okay, then I give you that, because if not, that's gonna be terrible. And I think this is what the Yellow Vest tried to achieve, right? Putting a level of pressure that was so high that the government would say, okay, we give this to you, because if we don't, we will end up in a much worse situation. The other sort of path to get it, it's with political parties that are always excluded from power. So in the US, for example, the United States, it was, yeah, political parties that were really willing to, they did not never have access to power. So they started using direct democracy as a way to, you know, get it. So it was with political party who were defending this, because if not, they don't have access. So that's why direct democracy in history has been defended by a lot of different parties. The very conservative Catholic in Switzerland, the liberal, the left-wing activist in the US, each time they had no power, it was a way for them to get access to power. And the third thing, third way of having direct democracy is worth, you know, when you have authoritarian experience, Italy, Spain, and these countries, you know, when you have an authoritarian experience and you are democratizing yourself with a new constitution, there is an introduction of direct democracy mechanism. But most of the time, they are impossible to use. So if you look at, for example, Eastern Europe, all the Eastern European countries, more or less, they have some direct democracy mechanism. But the Drempel, the threshold is so high that they can't use it. There's no way they can even win. So yeah, it's difficult, and we should not forget that, yes, elected politicians, once they are in power, losing for all the energy they invested in doing political campaign, you know, no, they don't want to do that. So yeah. I mean, this is also why in France we've seen a lot of party asking only this, only direct democracy, because they thought that if we have a full kind of programs, when we will be in power, we'll just do whatever we want to do, because it has been so tough to get there, and also because, yeah, you want to change. I mean, when you are in power. I had a discussion with one of the members of the parliament in France about direct democracy, because he was willing, his strong demand is that France get out of NATO. So it was North Atlantic Treaty Organization. So I said, but do a referendum. I mean, and he said, no, I want this so much that I don't think I will do a referendum on this. And this is interesting as a way of thinking, right? It's so important for me that no, this I will not go for a referendum for that.
Yeah. Dat is totaal ondemocratisch natuurlijk. Yeah. Maar goed. Maar ik denk ook, waarom wil men geen directe democratie? Principieel al is er een wantrouwen tegenover het volk.
Ja.
Een oud iets van wij zijn degene die verkozen zijn, wij moeten beslissen, wij kunnen dat. Maar ja, het volk kan je niet laten beslissen, dat is te gevaarlijk. Zij doen dat gewoon emotioneel en zo.
Ja.
Distrust.
Ja, and this is something that is super interesting to do if you have time. Well, I have time because it's my job, but if you have a bit of time. It's to look at the debates when the universal suffrage, so when everyone got access to vote in Europe. Because the type of arguments at that time is exactly the same we see right now. If we allow people to vote, that's going to be a nightmare. They're going to do things that are completely crazy. They are not able to decide by themselves. Same thing with the women's suffrage, actually. Yeah? When it was like, no, women are not able to think by themselves. It's going to be a disaster. And this is why I think right now with direct democracy, it's really about, yeah, the new political fight, the new fight for rights. And we see all, you know, the conservative forces saying, no, that's too dangerous. And they will, you know, get out surveys saying, oh, look, people are in support of death penalty, so they're going to reintroduce it, or they're going to do crazy stuff. And this is actually untrue, completely untrue.
Mm-hmm. Dus om dat even te pareren, die mensen waarvan de politici zeggen dat ze onbekwaam zijn om zichzelf te besturen, die zouden dan, let op, wel bekwaam zijn om het bekwaam politicus te kiezen. Dus die politicus die beweert dat de bevolking onbekwaam is, spreekt zichzelf tegen door te zeggen, jij moet wel bekwaam zijn om een bekwame politicus te kiezen.
Ja,
ja, dat is de tegenspraak. Hè.
Ja. Yeah, and what we see, I mean, this is what we try a bit to do with the book. I'm not sure it works because this is a difficult debate, but is to show that, because I don't know if you have this type of debate also in Belgium, but when we speak of direct democracy in France, a lot of people say, no, but before we educate people. So we have to educate people, and then later we're going to see what we do. You know, because if they know how to vote, that's going to be all right. And what is interesting is that direct democracy in itself is creating much more political education and knowledge than anything. There is a research we mention in the book showing that introducing initiative and referendum, only this, it's not super costly to introduce, it's as if you would bring all the people who have no diploma to the first diploma possible in the education system. It means that the effect of initiative and referendum on education is super high, because when people, you know, decide on something, when they have to discuss something, they learn a lot because they have to look at things. I mean, they have to also, yeah, get information on this. Yeah.
Bert, do you hear me, Bert? Hallo?
Ja, no. Marie-Claire.
Ja, hoor je mij?
Ja hoor,
ja.
Zeg maar.
Oh, okay. I have also a question. How is it possible, or I don't know the situation now in France with the whole corona craziness. So people... They, with the Gele Hesjes, I don't know the translation in English, the Gele Hesjes.
Yellow vest.
Where are there now corona craziness? Because I don't hear anything about France. I hear about Germany, about England, about America, about Holland. All the manifestations against these political decisions. It's like a dictatorship. So where is the direct democracy now in France? Mm. Where are these haters now? Mm. I don't understand. So can you tell me, Clara, a little bit about that now?
Yeah.
Because I don't find anything about France on even not on the independent news.
Yeah. It's but you're right, Marie-Claire. It's It is a tough time also because I think right now I'm doing a project on corona measures and their impact on democracy and rights and et cetera. And we did compare country together, and France sits with Hungary in terms of the level of the level of freedom restrictions and the severity of the enforcement of the measures. So basically you try to gather your 10 in the street, the police come and they just shoot, you know, tear gas. There's no sort of negotiation or discussion possible. So a lot of people do contest. And if you, I'm following a lot of yellow vest groups on social media, for example, you will see that there is a lot going on, but people are clearly afraid to go in the street right now, because they feel that they're going to be arrested, that they're going to be heavily fined. I don't know if you followed the number of people who lost an eye or a hand during the Yellow Vest demonstration, who were really shot at by the police. The level of repression was really high. And I would say human rights activists say that. So it was extremely high. So people do contest, they try to organize themselves, but there is also a sense that they feel that there is a level of feeling of insecurity, that if you go in the street, you're going to be shot at. That really it's the type of fear people have right now in France, which is less the case, of course, if you see discussion on the Netherlands when the police had to sort of, stop demonstration. Well, Of course, there is a lot. There is a level of enforcement that is high, but less high than it is in France. So people are afraid. Even if I don't know if you followed, there is a lot of discussion, a lot of people not complying with the measure. And what is a bit frightening is that there is also a lot of violence because, yeah, people start being really angry about what is going on. But you're right, it's less visible because people are afraid.
Mm-hmm.
They're tired, they're afraid, yeah.
Yes, a lot of people are afraid because also I was already 3 times in Brussels and 1 time in Den Haag. And also they arrest people, but although it's without violence, you know, it's I cannot say it's organized, but the one who is speaking from the Sirius Waarheid, you know, with us, Sirius Waarheid, NL, we have in Belgium, Sirius Waarheid in BA, although they are going on, and although they were arrested, I was not arrested.
Yeah.
But a lot of people were arrested. So the last time in Brussels, last Sunday, not this Sunday, but the Sunday before, there was also a threat from the policeman. They already are threatening, but we were not afraid. We were about 600 people. It's always the risk to be arrested that you have to see and to be very, very courageous, you know?
Yeah,
and to see how... I think we have to be very courageous because I think we have to be to see very far, otherwise it's too late what's going on. So the double agenda. Everything, the whole economic life is going to be destroyed, and it's one of the hidden agenda. So this is my question. Do people know also in France those double agenda? They are aware of it?
I think they are, but there is a sense of, you know, for example, well, are you also in a very tough lockdown in Belgium or less so, right? I don't know. Is it like really...
It's tough.
It's tough, Well, that's... Because in France, they are back into a very, for example, tough lockdown. And yeah, you mentioned also the economic, you know, the economic agenda. And what was quite telling is that so all the bookshops, all the small shops were closed, but not the supermarkets. Not all the very big companies were not closed because they were allowed. You know, people would be allowed basically to work. And that's it. And then the rest is they can't do so. They can demonstrate. And now with the corona, for example, in France, the corona is used to implement a tougher control on demonstration rights. So there is a law being debated in the parliament about the use of drone to control demonstration and then to take, you know, how do you go, like face recognition with drones so that you know you would get it more easily. So it's there is a societal project there, but the thing is that people are as you said, you have to be courageous to be in the street, and you have to feel that there is also a sense, because the media, I don't know how it is in Belgium, but the media is also I was completely, you know, I live in the Netherlands, so I see also a bit of the difference in the media treatment, even if the Netherlands is not perfect by far. But each time there is a media article on people who refuse to wear masks or people who are against corona measures, it says these are people with a psychological problem, mental health problem, inherently violent, selfish. So it's you know, there is a huge propaganda that makes you also feel that you're not so comfortable to say those things because you are afraid that, yeah, of course you are these people who are, you know, into this sort of
stigmatization.
Completely.
Yeah. Ja, mag ik misschien even... Henk schrijft hier, ik denk nou over welke macht in de mens zijn macht wil laten vasthouden. Als ze die kracht beentje ligt, dan zijn de politici stuurloos. Slechte leiders houden vast aan hun macht, maar goede leiders kunnen die valkuil in zichzelf toch doorzien. Stel het is geld voor jezelf naar je macht, dan is het toch met een goed pensioen oplosbaar. Het laatste versta ik zelf niet helemaal goed, maar oké. Okay. Henk kan misschien meer zeggen.
You are mute, Henk, ja. Yeah.
Did you understand it, Clara?
Yeah. I did. Yeah.
But I have to answer Guido. Guido, als iemand schadeloos wordt gesteld voor het werkloos worden als politicus naar zijn werk, dan heeft hij niet meer de innerlijke drang vanwege het geld om dat te doen.
Nee.
Dus dan heb je dat opgeheven. Dus ik probeer de kracht te zien die in die politici werkzaam is om vast te houden aan hun ideeën. Als ik onze eigen minister-president in Nederland zie, die man die geeft zichzelf 30 keer per jaar op, dan gaat hij gewoon een andere koers varen. Dat is helemaal niet moeilijk voor een goede leider.
Nee, maar de meeste zijn geen goede leiders. Hè?
Ja, die maar je begint bij een goede leider, Bert.
Die hebben heel hard gewerkt. Die hebben veel ellebogenwerk moeten doen om aan de macht te geraken. En die gaan dan nooit opgeven. Never.
Maar dan ben ik niet...
Dus ethisch, politiek is de selectie van de slechtste.
Ja, daar treed je een mens niet meer moreel ethisch tegemoet. Dat doe ik
nee, dus, er zijn enkele, enkele spijtoppotanten. Er zijn er die zich kunnen moreel standvastig houden, maar dat zijn er wel heel weinig, hoor.
Ja, de witte raven misschien wel, ja.
Het is de ijzeren wet van Michel die in politieke partijen geldt.
Je vraagt zelf om een ethische benadering van ieder lid van de democratie. Ja. Dan moet ik die mensen die daar zitten in de leiding ook zo benaderen.
Ja, tuurlijk. Maar je vraagt een verklaring.
Ja, ik zoek de kracht.
Je vraagt een verklaring waarom dat het niet zo ethisch is.
Ik zoek die kracht in de mens die hem dat laat doen.
Ja.
But you know, I remember, I don't know who said that, but... Perhaps it was Rousseau, right? He said, you can either take men as they are, with you know all their weakness, all their problems, and design the best institutions possible to prevent them from doing any harm, or you may want to wait for people who are good, but perhaps there will be no one, you know, because there is always sort of, you know, even this. I would say I'm a bit skeptical about the idea of good leaders. I think good institutions make leaders. Good leaders are leaders under control. So people that we can, because they need always to check, right? They need always to. They don't have free hands. They have to know. Okay, what can I do? Shall I do this? Shall I do that? I have to consult, etc. So yeah, I would say even this, because you know, good leaders, they may also not be in favor of democracy because they do think that their political agenda is very important and that this is democracy is not something that fits in the pictures, right? They want to do their political program. So I would rather fight for having institutions that allows people to behave properly when they're in power. And I think direct democracy is one of the key institutions that allows this. Allows the fact that if you think that your policy is accepted, then you're not afraid of direct democracy. You feel okay. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to live with the threat that each and every decision I take can be recalled by people. I'm fine with that.
Yeah,
no problem with that. And and you see now in Switzerland, it's funny because when you listen to political parties in Switzerland, they accept direct. I mean, it's very unpopular in Switzerland to say, oh, the people, they did not vote well, right? It's something you can't say. It's impossible, right? You know, yeah. Kicked out of power. But you have to be used to that. You have to accept that.
Mag ik eens vragen, Clara? Jij als Zwitserse, geboren Zwitserse, klopt dat wat ik iemand hoorde zeggen? Dat Zwitsers even ontevreden over hun politici zijn en over die partijen als bij ons, maar dat ze één ding niet kwijt willen, namelijk hun directe democratie. Klopt dat?
Yeah, I will rephrase the question and let me know if you understand, if I understand you well, right? Yeah. It's the idea that is Switzerland a direct democracy or not, right? No?
No. Well, I can ask it in English, of course. Yeah. So somebody told me that Swiss people are as... yeah, allez. Ontevreden.
Miscontent.
Yeah.
Unsatisfied
and so, and angry with their politicians, as we do. But one thing they never would
give up,
get lost, and that's direct democracy.
No, for sure. For sure.
Okay, that's
and
right.
And what is funny when you... perhaps you have that experience, but if you go to Switzerland and you go to a bar, right, you take a beer with someone and you explain how the political system in your country works. So you say, hey, look, me in my country, I elect people for say 5 years and then, you know, a Swiss will tell you, and if it doesn't work, what can you do? Well, I can demonstrate, I can go in the streets, but yes, and if it doesn't work, what can you do? And then say, well, I can't do anything. And they are like, no, that's not possible. This is, can't accept that. Yeah, of course, they are very happy with their institutions, for sure. Not with their politicians, but with the institutions, yeah. And what is interesting, if I may perhaps give a small figure on this, is that the people, you know, because people who are sort of have centrist or mainstream political opinions, most of the time they are happy with the political system because they have a chance to get their ideas in power. But what is really interesting in Switzerland is that people with the most radical idea, whether you take people that are highly anti-capitalist or people who are very conservative, they are the ones who support the more direct democracy. Because they feel that at least they can put an issue on the agenda, right? They can suggest something, which is not the case in our systems, right? I mean, if you are a minority, it's very hard to sort of have your issues, visible, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. can I ask if I'm... Of misschien in het Nederlands kan ik het wel vragen. Clara, is het mogelijk om even een korte schets te geven van het project dat je in Grenoble gedaan hebt?
Ja.
Dat zou me interesseren om er meer over te weten. Ja, dank je.
I'm the member of... of a group where it's a political party, which is called Mouvement pour le Dauphiné Démocratique. And we defend two things. So the first one is decentralization, I mean, federalism. So in the introduction, more power to the regions and to the cities in France. And the other is direct democracy. So on both of it, we don't have a lot of success, unfortunately. But the idea is to really sort of, it's being closer to the Swiss level, actually, to the Swiss model. So what we did is that we advised the city council in Grenoble to implement direct democracy at the local level. But once the state court canceled the decision, they did step back. So even they were highly supportive of direct democracy, But when they were elected, the first measure that they were not happy with or petition, they did, you know, sort of cancel the mechanism. And this group, so we are in touch with different other groups in France. We have approximately, I would say, 15 different groups. And we did create an organization that is gathering us all for direct democracy. Is it enough what I said, Guido? Do you have more specific requests?
No, thank you. Dominique vraagt eventjes, wat is democratie precies? dat is eigenlijk...
Well, I don't know, perhaps anyone can give his or...
Ja, ik wil wel hoor.
Wat
blijf? Ja, of Erik. Voilà, Erik is onze specialist daarin.
Ja, Erik. Ja. Je hebt me nog niet gehoord.
Democratie, dat is dus het woordje dat afstamt van demos en gratia, hè? Gratijn, dus van het Grieks. Volk en heersen of regeren. Dus het volk regeert en het volk is de verzameling van burgers. Dus het zijn dus de burgers zelf die regeren of die heersen. Dus een soevereiniteit van de burgers in hun samenleving. Dat wil zeggen dat als zij mogen regeren, dat zij in feite ook kunnen beslissen. Dus zij denken na over elementen in hun samenleving, over activiteiten, over projecten. En zij gaan met elkaar in discussie. Ze bespreken dat en uiteindelijk wordt er een referendum en een volksraadpleging dat geïnitieerd wordt door hen zelf, wordt er een beslissing genomen. Iedereen in elke burger, dus in eer en geweten. Dus de burger moet in principe in een directe democratie, dat is eigenlijk een pleonasme, hè, omdat dus twee keer hetzelfde benadrukt wordt, moet kunnen beslissen. Hij moet eigenlijk kunnen zelf bepalen wat er in zijn samenleving aan toe gaat. En dat wil zeggen dat hij dus in principe moet kunnen rechtsnormeren. Dus als dusdanig wordt door de burgers een rechtsstaat gecreëerd, doordat hij kan in groep de rechtsregels vastleggen. En dat hij zich dan ook moet aanhouden. Dus het is onvolwassen om te stellen dat wij als burgers, als volwassen burgers, ons moeten houden aan wetten, aan regels, aan voorschriften, aan directieven die uitgevaardigd worden door de politici, waar dat wij niets kunnen aan toevoegen hebben, waar dat wij geen inbreng aan gehad hebben. Dat wordt dus allemaal boven onze hoofden vastgelegd en wij worden dus in principe als kinderen behandeld in nogthans een volwassen samenleving. Dus in een democratie is het dus eigenlijk de burger die het laatste woord heeft. Wat dat niet betekent dat er dus geen representatie kan zijn van de burgers. Dus dat kan gewoon zijn door voting of ook door loting. Maar als de burgers niet akkoord zijn, moeten zij in principe zich altijd kunnen verzetten tegen wat dat er beslist is. En de meerderheid haalt het. En als ze ook niet akkoord zijn met politici die bepaalde dingen doen die zij niet goed vinden... Mensen die over de grenzen gaan, dan moeten zij wat wij noemen een recall-procedure kunnen starten. Ja. Zodanig dat het ook aan de burgers is om hen af te zetten in die zin. Ja. Dat is eigenlijk in het kort wat democratie op neerkomt. Ja.
Mag ik er iets aan toevoegen?
Ja.
Eigenlijk komt het erop neer. Er wordt gezegd, dus in dat gesprek wat Erik zojuist geschilderd heeft, daar spreken wij af hoe we met elkaar omgaan. En die afspraken, hoe wij met elkaar omgaan, dat resulteert in wetten. En nu wordt gezegd, daar is iedereen wel over akkoord, iedereen is gelijk voor de wet. Maar wat vergeten wordt erbij te zeggen is, opdat iedereen gelijk zou zijn in het gehoorzamen van de wet, moet iedereen ook gelijk zijn in het maken van de wet. Dus dat wil zeggen dat iedereen een gelijke, vrije stem moet hebben in het maken van de wetten, in de wetsproductie. Dus eigenlijk houdt het dus in dat diegenen die de gevolgen van een wet of een beslissing moeten dragen, toch minstens de kans moeten hebben om mee te beslissen in het tot stand komen van die wet. En dat is ook het hart van de democratie.
Mm-hmm. Mooi.
Yeah, and I think it's really important what Eric said is the idea. It's the idea that citizens, the people, they can't be overruled. So if they say no to something, there's no other authority who can say, oh, but yeah, they say no, but it's a yes. So it's the idea that really the final word is with the people, and what the people decide can't be changed because they have they have really the final word. So that's why in France we focus on the constitution to say no. So there's one tool that we did not discuss tonight, but I think is very important, and this is what my research is about in particular, is what we call mandatory referendum. So it's the idea that for some decision you have no choice but to go with a referendum. And if you lose the referendum, the decision you can't take it. You have it on some, for example, fiscal measures, on some measures related to rights, to international treaties. For some decision, it is automatic. You have to call a popular vote. And if you lose it, you lose it. That's it. You can't just, you know, take the measures in other way. Yeah.
Okay. Dominique vraagt ook wat het belang is van de publieke opinie in de politiek.
Ja.
De media?
Het belang voor de politici is dat ze de burgers aan hun kant moeten krijgen. Hè. Dat is het belang.
Maar dus in democratie, ja, de
publieke opinie... De burgers moeten de politici aan hun kant krijgen. Het is omgekeerd.
Dat is juist.
Ja, maar in een democratie heeft de media de rol van het voorstel dat op de agenda staat goed te verspreiden. Op een eerlijke, evenwichtige manier. In Zwitserland wordt er dan een brochure verdeeld, hè, Clara?
Ja.
Ik heb er hier nog enkele liggen. Dus dat is ook iets zeer unieks, dat men eigenlijk de voor- en de tegenstanders over een thema aan het woord laat.
Tuurlijk.
Ik heb nog een vraagje voor Clara. Er was een tijdje geleden in Zwitserland, ik denk in Basel, een betoging van vrouwen.
Oh ja.
Voor iets bepaalds. Ik weet niet meer juist waarover dat het ging, maar de vrouw...
Ah, Erik. Ja. Ja, ik dacht dat het ging over de loonkloof nog. Dat ze dus gelijk loon wilden. Denk ik, als ik me goed herinner.
Ja. Wel, dus snap je het, Clara? Dus weet jij ervan, van die betoging in Basel?
I didn't hear you very well, because it was from far away. So, can you repeat the question?
Yes, there was a manifestation. Some time ago, there was a manifestation, I think, in Basel, from women. Yeah, women?
Women.
People on the street, I think it was only women. But normally, we expect then that when you live in a direct democracy, it is not necessary to come on the street or to manifestate, because you can introduce a referendum if you want. You have to have a sample of votes from people, so you can initiate a referendum. So we think here in Belgium, when we have the possibility for referenda and petitions, it isn't anymore necessary to come into the street for a manifestation.
No, you are right, but it's on average. So if you look, because there are research, right, on what is the relationship between direct democracy and other forms of political mobilization. So there are some articles, and I can send you some of them, or, you know, what is the impact of, say, direct democracy on the numbers of demonstrations, for example. This still exists. But this is on average, and Switzerland has a typical, I would say, issue in terms of gender equality. That perhaps you followed the debates of women in Switzerland were granted the right to vote in 1973.
Yeah.
Last region, 1995.
That's right.
It seems like, oh God, right? So it's still these issues are still very pregnant, and it doesn't mean that women will not use the direct democracy, but it means that demonstration will be more limited, and it is a complement. Because if you want to attract attention, because a key problem, for example, in Switzerland, it's about direct democracy. Even if it's much better than anything we have, is the fact that there is no regulation on the right to speak from the people holding the petition. So there is a recurring complaint in the Netherlands about the fact that when you have a petition, you are a group of people, you have a petition, if the media wants to kill it, they will, because they will do a campaign which is about no, this is not possible. So people feel, you know, when you are a small association, they feel, well, we have to be visible. So sometimes a demonstration is a way of being more visible and attracting the media opinion.
Yeah.
But it's a compliment. It's the idea that you want to be. So that's why in Switzerland right now, there is a lot of debate on, shall we guarantee a speaking time for the people having the petition, so that they have access to the media and they can really speak and they have the visibility.
Yeah.
Because right now, and this is something we see in researchers, a petition, anyone can do it. So it's there is no, because sometimes perhaps you hear it in Belgium, people saying, oh yeah, but you know, direct democracy, it's all about lobbies. So people will just, you know, they will try to, this is not true. What is, so initiative can be done by different groups. What is true is that if the mainstream media, they want to kill an initiative, they will. And they will do a campaign of, you know, what we call campaign of fear. Because what we have seen is that when people, they are unsure about a decision, they vote no. They say that, you know, it's if they have doubt. So for example, there is a lot of discussion in Switzerland about health insurance. I don't know if you know how the system works in Switzerland. So you have to pay. It's extremely expensive. It's private insurance. And there is always petitions and initiative and referendum for social security. The idea that there will be something public for that. And it always fails because basically the media, the insurance company, they pay the media to do a campaign about, hey, be careful, that's going to be a disaster, etc. So sometimes the demonstration, especially for some groups, is a way of attracting media opinion, that people will think, okay, well, we see that they are in the street, we have to sort of discuss that topic, right? But it's much less, it's not mass demonstration blocking, you know, the economy.
No, of course.
It's not at all the same, no.
Mm-hmm.
As we have in France.
Ja, als de mainstream media hier zijn in België, dan verzie ik hier ook enorme problemen als we een referendum mogelijkheid krijgen.
It's a problem.
Yeah.
But what we see is that what is good also with direct democracy. Because sometimes I hear, you know, yes, but you have to change the media before doing democracy. But the thing is, you know, the example we have in France is the 2005 referendum on the treaty for the constitution in Europe. All the medias and the Brexit, look at the Brexit, all the medias were saying, no, you should have vote to, you know, for Europe, etc. And in the end, people, they manage, you know, they discuss. You don't need to regulate that, because now with internet, people, they find their information in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Mag ik nog iets vragen?
Ja.
Hallo. Clara, in this very special time, I would like to say now is the moment to be very, to have a very clear thought about direct democracy, because our freedom is taken our civil rights are taken, and the total economic life has been destroyed nearly. Mm. So this is the moment to wait now for the people. And that's my question. How can we awake them? How can we awake them? Because
I can give a very Sorry, Marie-Claire, go ahead.
Yes, something small again, something small added also to the people of Switzerland, because they have already the opportunity to have direct democracy on a high level. Why they are not awakened? Why they are only thinking, I don't know, perhaps there are people, some people, but I don't know them, why they are not awakened for the whole world? And to awaken the whole world now, because also their freedom is going to be taken, because they have also not, it's not so severe as in Belgium or Germany and other countries of Europe and in other countries of the world. But they have to be, I find, they have to be to develop their heart for the whole world. Mm-hmm. To awaken the whole world for it, because this is the moment to awaken now.
Well, I think, well, perhaps a good news in this very bad times, and I can share an article with you. I can perhaps even translate it in Dutch. You know, the cholera epidemic in Switzerland, the huge epidemic of cholera, did bring direct democracy. It was a key trigger. Okay, it was the same. You know, people would feel that they were highly controlled. I mean, there was really the same. Of course, it was very like long ago. I can send you an article that was written by a Swiss colleague and about the role of epidemic in bringing also, you know, change, because sometimes you need this. I mean, you need it. Don't get me wrong, that I don't think it's a good thing, but sometimes, you know, these key events, they wake up, right? You feel that no way, not even like we have to fight for our rights. And and I can share this with you so that we may be confident about Switzerland. It's a bit, I think, you know, they are having knowing the country fairly well, there's two things in this. First, very important, there is an article in the Swiss Constitution saying that Switzerland will support any initiative to promote direct democracy. And this is interesting because, for example, us in France, we are trying to organize an event with the Swiss in Paris to bring them using their constitution, saying, hey, guys, you are supposed to help us there. You can't, I mean, it's in your constitution that you have to promote, right, direct democracy. This is part of your identity. But at the same time, Switzerland, and if you look at Swiss history, it's even, you know, Switzerland in itself, it's very hard to speak of a single country. Because it's all, you know, different, you know, the canton, it's all very different. And there's always this threat to, you know, if we start, you know, interfering in other people's affairs, we're going to end up in a very difficult situation, because the history of Switzerland is a small country, hopefully with the mountain, they can protect themselves, but close to, you know, I mean, France invaded them. They also stopped all direct democracy mechanism after the French Revolution. So there is still this, I don't know how to explain, I know it's a bit irrational, but there is this mindset that, if we start, you know, interfering on things, but we can use, of course, the article in the Constitution to start, you know, bring them. And I think this is also why Democracy International has also such a strong connection with Switzerland, because this is also the idea, right, that they would promote it. I know times are tough, but I really do believe that there will be an after Corona. Because people are really now waking up and they are looking at ways of controlling better the decision. Well, it took, you know, when direct democracy was forbidden in Switzerland, it took them 30 years to get it back. I'm just saying this to, you know, as a way of it. It took them a lot of time. So I think it's important to take direct democracy as, and sometimes it's difficult, is that this is the first thing we should ask. We should not ask for, you know, higher wage. We should ask for being able to decide. And all the rest, it's great, but it's not the agenda. And once we are really into, you know, this is what we want, this is what we want, this is what we want. Because now sometimes, I don't know how the situation is in Belgium, but in France, it's, you know, people ask different things right now, right? It's about, you know, raising the salaries. And I'm really sympathetic with the idea. But we should really be, I mean, there should be this. And now we have, you know, signs of this with also me coming to discuss with you. There is a connection there, but we have to be stronger in ways of saying, okay, I mean, Corona told us that what we want is control. This is not possible anymore. What we want is really to gain control and have our rights, you know, defended by us and not by someone else. But it's tough.
Ik heb ook nog een vraag in verband met Van Rijbroek. David Van Rijbroek promoot hier het lotingssysteem via de burgerpanels en dergelijke. En daar was Paul Nolle meldde ons dat er een referendum in voorbereiding was om een deel van het parlement of zo te vervangen door geloten burgers. Hoe ver staat dat? Of wat is daar vandaan? Staan de Zwitsers daar tegenover?
Ah, Zwitserland, oké.
In Zwitserland. Ja. I'm not this randomly selected people. I'm not, to be honest, I'm not, this is perhaps something that you can ask Raoul, because I'm not really an expert of these tools, basically because I don't like them so much. I'm always afraid that this could be also a way of distracting from, because once you have representative, even if they are randomly selected, it's always the same issues. What is important, what is unique with initiative and referendum is that each individual has a right to initiate something. And once you have randomly, you know, a selected assembly, then you lose this right, because I give my right to initiate something to someone else. This someone may be someone that I really like and I have same ideas, but I lose a right. I lose my right to initiate something. So even if I have the referendum after it, it's really not the same. And you know, sometimes when I am with the German from Democracy International, they told me, well, but why are you so opposed to participatory democracy? It goes, you know, it goes together. And I'm like, no, but in France, it does not, because this is the only thing we have, because they don't want to give the direct democracy mechanism. So that's why I would say a bit cautious with that. But of course, in Switzerland, that's a compliment. There are a lot of new initiatives in Switzerland to try to also, you know, improve the system, I would say.
Ja, ik heb hier wordt het die burgerpanels ook als een schaamlapje gebruikt om niet het zelfbeslissingsrecht van de burger toe te laten.
Ja.
En vandaar dat wij in het algemeen daar niet echt happig op zijn en daar ook niet met die daarop echt op zit te springen.
Ja.
Ja.
No, clearly, and some people may be seduced, right? They will feel, but that's already something. But no, I mean, if you start accepting this, you're completely screwed.
En het toppunt is dus dat David van Rijbroek tegen referenda is. Hij is helemaal tegen referenda.
Yeah. And they will take, you know, and I think this all Brexit stories plays also, because people will use it, right? Say, hey, look, you want your referendum, see now you took a decision, it's completely crazy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it's very hard to explain, but this is not what I want. And even, you know, when I explain to colleagues in the academia, no, but this is not initiative and referendum, they're like, oh yeah, well, I didn't know. Yeah, but of course you didn't know, but then don't say that this is it, because this is not it. We know that when, you know, the political parties, they initiate a the government initiates a referendum, we have plenty of examples that it doesn't work. This is not what we want.
Ja, ik denk ook dat het, als die burgerpanels iets meer ingeburgerd wordt, dat we van de directe democratie nog veel, veel verder weg zijn.
Ja.
Zou kunnen. Behalve natuurlijk, maar inderdaad, je zal gelijk hebben, Bert. Je zou natuurlijk kunnen stellen, oké, laat misschien een vertegenwoordigend burgerpanel iets beslissen, maar leg die beslissingen dan voor aan het volk.
Ja, dat is, maar dat natuurlijk, is wat wij dan eisen. Hè?
Ja, maar dat zal misschien in de praktijk heel moeilijk worden.
Dat gaan ze nooit niet willen, want ze zeggen de beslissing is goed.
Ah ja, natuurlijk. Waarom?
De enquêtes en zo. Want die zijn meestal ook wel goed, omdat het door burgers, als het vele burgers zijn die kunnen meedoen aan de loting, die zijn ook wel kwalitatief beter dan van een parlement. Maar het ondergraaft het zelfbeslissingsrecht.
Ja.
En ik weet niet if you read this, I think the book was published in Dutch before. It's called Diploma Democracy. From two colleagues in Utrecht. Yeah. And it's about the fact that all this, you know, citizen assembly, they put the same people, I mean, that's the same people that I would say socially that we have in political parties elsewhere, right? That's actually, if you want to change the game, you have to give each individual people the right to decide for his own life.
Yeah, right? That's right. That's the point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's tough. What is the situation of the debate in Belgium right now? Is there a debate about direct democracy?
Not especially. Oh, no. Well, there's a movement, coma. You know.
Deep sleep.
Well, there is a certain movement, yes, but not on political level.
We sit in the catacomb.
Well, we are with you guys in the catacomb.
Well, it's not easy because I think in Belgium it's a few people who understand the necessity of direct democracy. Even our members are not convinced about the need of direct democracy or the principal need of direct democracy. So we have to fight in our own with our own members to get direct democracy on the first level.
We did something that I did not mention, that we tried in France and we are trying with Arjen and Nisco in the Netherlands, is to organize training for elected officials about what is direct democracy. And the idea is to make them aware that they can't be against, because that's gonna be, you know, against them. That's gonna play against them. So it's really not easy, because even in the Netherlands, right? They are not supportive of it, right? They are always saying no, but we should not run against the representative system. We should, you know, it should be something that is used the less possible. Like, we should not use it a lot, which is a problem in itself. You know, if you give a political right and say to people, yeah, you should not use it a lot, like, it's really not easy.
Ja, maar om zo'n trainingen te geven heb je wel heel wat geld nodig, hè? Want dat is wel.
Yeah, it's silly, but okay. necessary.
We zouden ook mee kunnen beginnen aan een academie, degene die de opleidingen, allee, dit kunnen we beschouwen als een deel van een opleiding. Hè?
En
studiepunten te verzamelen.
Ja. Ja, maar goed. Ja.
Ja. Dus dan zouden we een opleidingstraining kunnen geven, mensen die hier altijd bij zijn. Dat zullen degenen zijn die het doen. Hè?
Ja.
Die het kunnen verder doordragen. Hè?
Tuurlijk. Goed, zijn er nog... Ah ja, Elisa heeft een vraag.
Wel, een vraag. Het is eigenlijk dat laatste stuk dat Clara nu zei, dat ik niet heel goed begrepen heb. Want daarop zegt Bert, misschien moeten we dan een academie oprichten of zo, om te onderrichten. Ja. Maar dus ik merk dat ik iets gemist heb van wat Clara zei in verband met die directe democratie.
Ik denk, het ging erover dat Arjen en Nisco in Nederland de politici opleidingen ging geven, dachten te geven rond directe democratie. Wat is dan nu directe democratie? Dat ze daar ook geen bang voor moeten zijn.
Ja. En wie ging dat doen? Van wie ging dat uit?
Van Arjen Nijenboer.
Ja, van Meer Democratie Nederland.
En Nisco Dubbelboer, ja, dat zijn de leidende figuren van Meer Democratie Nederland.
Ja, in Nederland, ja, dat weet ik, ja.
Ja, ja.
Ah, en die hadden een initiatief om daarover inleidingen te geven.
Een idee.
Ja, this is because Elisa, we did that in France, especially at the local level.
Ah, okay.
And when I arrived in Groningen, you know, I had contact with Ariane and Nisco, and we thought, hey, we have to do that. Instead of having these politicians trained about, you know, crazy stuff, citizen assemblies, let's bring them to Switzerland, let's explain what it is. Okay. And because they say, well, I think you have the same experience. When you discuss with a politician, they know less than us about what is there. They have no idea about what it is.
No.
They don't know. So they continue to say crazy stuff, right? I mean, they really don't know anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes saying, hey, but it's Switzerland use it, right? It's not a country in chaos. I don't think Switzerland is the most chaotic country on earth, right?
It's not a failed state.
No, it's not a failed state.
Like Belgium is.
They are doing very well, right?
Yeah.
That was the idea, yeah.
Okay, but, thank you well. Yeah, this is duidelijk. Thank you. Yeah.
Graag gedaan.
Bert, mag ik nog even iets zeggen?
Ja,
hallo.
Ja.
We luisteren. I think in Holland or in the Netherlands, there is now a party, the Forum for Democracy, with Thierry Baudet. I think he knows exactly what it really contains, direct democracy.
Yeah.
Perhaps we can ask him to give lectures about direct democracy, something like that, because he can tell it very clearly.
Ja, mag ik daarop antwoorden?
Ja.
Ja, ik als een politieker dat tegen een andere politieker gaat zeggen, krijgt men direct een soort oppositie.
Tuurlijk.
Ja. Die zitten eigenlijk altijd in een strijdmodus. Dus vandaar dat wij met onze beweging, enfin, ik toch, niet met de politiek gaat meedoen.
I see that Dominique said that he has never been in Switzerland. Well, we should do a study trip together. Go there.
After Corona,
let's hope so. Yeah.
Ja, dat dachten we ook te organiseren. Hè.
Ja.
Maar dus die conferentie met Democracy International vond ik wel echt fantastisch.
Ja.
Want, het, het, Het voor mij mogen daar echt modules bij zijn van opleiding.
Ja.
Mm-hmm. Echt opleiding, dagen opleiding. Dat was iets dat ik een gemiste kans zag eigenlijk. Er waren wel enkele sprekers en zo, Zwitsers en zo verder. Maar toch vond ik het, kon er een gestructureerde opleiding gegeven worden. Misschien is het een idee om daar gewoon weg mee te beginnen nu.
Ja. Nou ja, zeker.
Ja, ik vind dat ook.
Hetgeen dat wij eigenlijk nu doen. Nee, Guido heeft al uiteenzetting gegeven, en Erik en zo. Wat is direct democratie en zo verder? Jij ook, hè, Clara, dus dat is echt fantastisch. Hè,
ja.
Dat nu nog wat meer mensen hierbij krijgen.
Ja.
Mm-hmm. Want anders zijn we toch voor ons eigen aan het spreken, hè.
Natuurlijk.
Ja, and I believe that, you know, I was thinking of Marie-Claire's question. And something I really believe is that if you tell people around you, you know what you are telling me right now, it's actually the same thing that people said to prevent women from voting, to prevent people mm-hmm. from voting. Yeah. You are on this side, so
yeah.
select your side well, because I don't think you are in the right one. And this is also, I think, something we should be perhaps more vocal about. You know, it's not really, do you want that history remembers you as the guy who was, you know, saying that, yeah, well, no, it's not so much of a good idea, right, this thing? Because this is what we see right now. So trying to push a bit the propaganda the other way so that, yeah, the people who are against it would feel, oh my God, this is really not something I should say, right? And this is, I think, what also Democracy International is trying to do, that showing that there is a movement here and we are not alone, right? If in some countries it may be difficult, but at least if we all unite, that's going to be...
Ja, maar Marie-Claire is een felle, hoor. Die heeft geen mondmasker. Die zet geen mondmasker op, hoor. Marie-Claire. Geldt er geen doekje voor, hè?
No. I can work with sound, but I'm very creative with it, you know.
Ja.
But also, I meet a lot of people, aggressive people also.
Ja.
To me.
Elisa, wou jij niet nog iets vragen? Ja, hè?
Ja, wel, ik wou eigenlijk vragen, zo van, allez, zo gelijk brainstorming, maar wat zou mensen dan wel warm maken? Allez, ik versta wat Clara zegt, als je tegen mensen, of bijvoorbeeld zeker tegen vrouwen zou zeggen, ja, nu de argumenten die nu aangehaald worden, dat zijn dezelfde argumenten waarmee ze ons stemrecht in de tijd ook hebben tegengehouden.
Ja.
Maar aan de andere kant vraag ik mij af, zo mochten we in mensen van binnen kunnen kijken, bij wijze van spreken, van ja, wat zou een klik kunnen maken om dat mensen de aha-erlevenis zouden hebben? Maar ja, natuurlijk, we moeten daarvoor zijn. Dat is eigenlijk mijn vraag. Allee.
Did you in something that worked well in France for that we did, and I know that in Netherlands they did too, is organizing direct democracy, so initiative and referendum mm-hmm. in your streets, at schools, you know, or at work, or with, you know, it's, you just do it, you know, you don't ask if the city hall is happy with that. You just go with your neighbor and you say, hey, let's try it. And then people, when they do experience it, they do it and they're happy, they vote on something, they have to write the law. It feels like, oh my God, that's great. Because we got to discuss. And I didn't know that, for example, my neighbor, two houses there, she actually thinks the same that I do. And then it helps, just trying it. And we did... with Raoul, we did a lot of games. So we have some You know, we do some conferences where we do that. So we ask to the people, hey, I'm sure you have something you want to do in your life. Think about it. And then people go back and say, oh, yeah, yeah, I want to do that. And they write something. And then you say, hey, but try to collect signature from people. And then when they feel it's really, I think, living this, experiencing this, we stop speaking about it. We do it, right? We just try to experience it. And then people feel, my God, this is so great and so simple in some ways that you feel, yeah, completely, yeah. Yeah.
Ja, we hebben dat gedaan met de Lange Wappen referendum in Antwerpen.
Ah, ja. Ja,
en wat dat was echt een warm moment.
Ja.
En wat nu toch eigenlijk ook wel wat gebeurt met de ring, hè, met Ringland. Hè?
Ja, ja.
Ja.
Ja, dat is nog iets anders, vind ik. Ik snap, Elisa, sorry. Ik vind met Ringland echt, ja...
Okay.
Ik vind dat wij ons een beetje... Al die handtekeningen die wij hebben moeten afgeven... Sorry. Ja, ik ben daar niet zo heel tevreden over. Echt niet. Mm-hmm. Ik heb nu dingen gehoord, onlangs ook weer, maar ik ga het nu niet vertellen. Waar ik helemaal teleurgesteld van ben. Ik vind als mensen zoveel energie opbrengen om handtekeningen te verzamelen... En dan voor een intendant... die ineens gewoon uit een woord verschijnt, potverdorie, omdat de politiekers bang zijn van de burgers in Antwerpen. Er waren 75.000 handtekeningen opgehaald. Ja, ik heb spijt dat ik toen niet in Antwerpen woonde, want mijn handtekeningen hadden niet moeten afgeven, want ik denk dat ik op de barricade had gestaan. Sorry hoor. Ik vind dit echt een verraad, echt waar. Ik blijf daarbij. En er komt dus nu, zeker met dat corona-gedoe, er komt niks van terug bijna. En er is dan maar ene die gewoon in ik weet al niet meer hoe dat het lint is, dat BAM-tracé zit in dat bestuur, die moet het dan maar uithouden. En ik heb nu onlangs gehoord dat die nu meewerkt met de BAM. Allee, ik bedoel dat hij werkzaam is, dat weet ik niet. Maar ik heb gewoon al gedacht van, hoe kan u één iemand van een burgerbeweging, die een burgerbeweging voorziet, hoe kan zo iemand dat uithouden? En hij heeft al werk, hij werkt nu ook daarvoor. En ik weet nu niet...
Ik wou eens vragen... Ah, Marie-Claire, wat bedoel je, Marie-Claire, met handtekeningen afgeven?
Ja, dat was de voorwaarde, hè. Dus om dat toekomstverbond op te richten. Dus samenwerkingen. Politiekers en de burgerbeweging. Ik noem dat verraad. Sorry. Ik heb dat ook gezegd. Ik heb heel veel respect gehad voor hun Hanees. Maar al die burgers die gewoon potverdorie de moeite hebben gedaan voor die handtekeningen. En dan was er toch nog een voorwaarde van het beroep dat ze aangetekend hebben. Om dat terug te zeggen, ik weet niet meer juist welk beroep. Dat zijn uw wapens afleveren aan een vijand. Dat doe ik niet. No? Ik ik zie dat ook niet echt goed vooruit gaat. Je hebt een eeuwig lange discussie en zeker nu met die corona waanzin helemaal. Het lijkt wel of het wist van te horen. En normaal, als we de verborgen agenda wisten, de verborgen agenda, dat was wel heel langer, hè. Ze hebben dat goed gespeeld, man. Ja. Ik ben heel erg ontgoocheld. En met veel respect voor Peter Vermeulen, met veel respect voor Manu Kluis en veel respect voor Wim van Eet. Maar nog meer respect voor al de burgers die aan die handtekeningen opgehaald. Sorry. Ik ben blij dat ik niet meer in Antwerpen woonde en dat ik niet op die barricade had gestaan. Want dat had niet waar geweest bij mij. Dan had ik echt daarna gevochten. Maar dat is mij echt ontstaan, want ik woonde niet meer in Antwerpen en ik was dus met andere dingen bezig. Maar als ik dat hoorde, ik heb echt gehuild. Ik denk, hoe is dat in godsnaam mogelijk? Je hebt allemaal gecapituleerd en geen enkele allee. En ik heb nu ook gehoord dat onlangs nog maar, dat het dan, en dat heb je dan bijna alleen gestaan in Zwijndrecht, dat het een ingenieur is in Zwijndrecht die de eerste ring geworpen had of zo. Dat is een schande gewoon. En samen nog met een burgemeester van Zwijndrecht. Godverdorie. Ongelooflijk, ik zou bijna kunnen roepen hebben. Ik heb het nu nog maar vandaag. Elisa, sorry hoor. Dat kan gewoon niet meer. Dat kan niet. Dat is geen burgerbeweging meer.
Ze zijn ingepakt.
Dat is burgers ontmoedigd.
Ja. Dat is ook goed. De ijzeren wet die daar geldt. Hè.
Ja, sorry voor het strijdlustige, maar...
Nee.
Dominique vraagt ook iets.
Ja?
Kan je mensen warm maken voor een Green Deal? Nu, ik wil daar ook iets over zeggen. Een Green Deal is een voorstel en wij als direct democraten hebben daar wel wat te beslissen. Dat kan een referendum worden. Dat is mijn gedachte.
Ja, inderdaad. Dat zijn de mensen die dat moeten onderling beslissen, in principe. Maar in een echte democratie kan dat.
Go ahead. Het
is belangrijk iets zijn in feite, die Green Deal, maar in feite zouden dus die Europese leiders, en inderdaad dus verantwoordelijke, goede leiders zouden zijn, zouden ze dat moeten voorleggen aan de Europese burger. In een referendum.
Serieus, surtout omdat dat heel veel geld gaat kosten. Hè? Ja.
Want ik denk dat het... Dat is een vraagje voor Clara nog. In Zwitserland zijn er dus obligatoire referenda.
Ja.
Ja. Onder andere voor verandering van de grondwet.
Ja.
En ook voor grote uitgaven.
Ja.
Dus een Green Deal, veronderstelt dat Zwitserland daar zou in meegaan. Hè? Zouden ze dat moeten in een referendum voorleggen aan de burgers?
Ja. Ja, it's automatic, right? So if you want to change, so that's why, well we can, because they have it in Ireland too. They have it in Denmark. So for constitutional matters, so they have it, right? It's really, and this is, I think, something that is very important. So that's why in France and the book we have with Raoul, so we did prepare an Italian version and we adapted country per country. Find the right referendum, and we try to introduce both together because it's very, and most of the time what we see, and this is something interesting, is that in history the country will manage to have direct democracy, they started with a compulsory referendum. So for example, Switzerland, they didn't have initiative right for very long, but they started with that. My experience is that when you tell to people, yes, but I mean, we should vote for some, you know, for the constitution, they would accept it more easily than initiative and referendum. And once you have it, you get to the next step very quickly. Because once you allow people to vote, so yeah.
Ja, dat is een goede strategie.
Ja.
Dat is een goede strategie.
Ja.
Ja, ik denk dat we zo stilaan aan onze tijdslimiet komen.
Ja, dan binnen 2 weken een vervolg?
Ja.
Of
Clara, is dat right?
Ja. Oké.
Okay, I'm happy. If you are happy, I'm happy.
Yes, I think so.
Ja, zeker.